You may remember the video I did about this Optimus DCT2000 Digital Compact Cassette deck, which I found at a thrift store. And it goes through all the motions. You can put in a tape, you can play it, rewind it, fast forward it, but when you play it, you don't get any audio from either digital or analog tapes, and that's because of bad surface mount electrolytic capacitors. A lot of electronics from the early 90s used those capacitors, and after 25 or so years, they've leaked out their electrolyte. And if you catch them just in time, you may be able to temporarily get it working again just by washing the electrolyte off the circuit boards, such as you may have seen in Techmoan's video, in which he used that technique to get a Macintosh computer working again. Well, I tried it with this one, and unfortunately it was not good enough to get it working. But then I found this deck on eBay. It's a Philips DCC900. It was their first generation of DCC deck. This was advertised in working condition. I paid $113 plus shipping on it, which is really not a bad price at all for one of these in working condition. And to my pleasant surprise, when I first got it, it actually was working. I put in my DCC tape of John Hite and it played perfectly. But then I put in an analog tape and I heard a very low output level, especially in the left channel. So I knew it was already suffering from bad capacitors. It was just not as bad as the Optimus was. And I was planning to get this one repaired correctly, but in the meantime I figured I would just try cleaning the circuit boards with some isopropyl alcohol and a cotton swab. And that turned out to be a mistake, because with the slightest pressure of my cotton swab, I managed to knock off one of the tiny surface mount transistors on the board. The reason why that happened is because the electrolyte that leaks out of those capacitors is corrosive and can damage the circuit board and the solder joints of the components attached to it. And at that point, I knew I needed professional help, not just because I'm crazy enough to mess around with a dead format like this, but because of two DCC decks, I really wanted to get at least one of them working. So that's when I contacted Ralf, better known as Dr. DCC, of the DCC Museum in beautiful Redondo Beach, California. You can reach him at his website, which is dccmuseum.com, or on his YouTube channel, which is Dr. DCC. And I got in touch with him, and we worked out a deal where I would send him the parts of both of these decks, and hopefully he will be able to get at least one of them working again. Because as part of his quest to keep the DCC format alive, he runs a repair service for these decks. Now I have to admit, he gave me a special discount on his price in exchange for my promotion of his repair service in this video, but even if he didn't, I would have enlisted his help anyway, because if there's anyone in the world that has the skills, tools, and knowledge to repair these decks, it's Dr. DCC. So I sent them the mechanisms and circuit boards from these two decks. With these component-style DCC decks, you don't need to send in the whole thing, because as we'll see later when we look inside, the parts are pretty much interchangeable. So he can take the parts from your machine and put it into one of his test machines when he's working on it. And right now you're seeing some of the photos he sent me of his repair of these machines. Now unfortunately, the Optimus deck was not able to be repaired, because even with new capacitors, it was not working again. That's because of the special heads in these machines. They're a little bit fragile, both electrically and mechanically. And if one of those goes bad, that's it for the machine, because nobody makes them anymore. So the only way to get a new head is to cannibalize one from another DCC deck. So unfortunately, the Optimus deck is still not working, but the Philips is now fully restored, so I can give it a proper demonstration. Here's a look inside the Philips. The build quality does appear to be higher than the Optimus, because while the Optimus just used some plastic sticks to hold the circuit boards in place, this one has this big metal bracket, which I'll remove so we can get a better look at them. And there's the most major difference between the two. This second circuit board, the larger one, appears to be an older design, because instead of surface mount capacitors, it has all these conventional electrolytic capacitors, which may be older technology, but nowadays, 25 years later, that's actually an advantage, because these are still good, while those surface mount capacitors were leaking and needed to be replaced. So generally, this kind of board does not cause any problems, does not need any repair work. But otherwise, this entire tape mechanism is actually identical to the one in the Optimus. The only difference is the faceplate. Otherwise, the tape mechanisms would be interchangeable between the two machines. Even the connectors are the same. And also, this circuit board is identical between the two. And you can see some of those capacitors that were replaced by Dr. DCC. But one notable difference is that it plugs in the other way. In the Optimus, the ribbon cable was towards the back. On the Philips, it's towards the front. So you just have to keep that in mind so you don't plug it in the wrong way. There's a closer look at the work that was done. On the A side of this board, there were 7 capacitors that were replaced. And there's that little circuit board mounted directly to the tape mechanism. I can't get a good view of it because I don't want to remove the whole mechanism again. But on the other side of that board, which we can't see right now, there are also some of those surface mount electrolytic capacitors which were replaced. And that contraption is actually a motor driven potentiometer, and that's for controlling the output level of the variable outputs. Although I believe you need the remote control to do that, because there's no output level control on the front panel. And you can see some of the adjustments for the analog playback, including the Dolby and the levels for the channels. I did have to tweak that one right there. These two, the one hidden by the wire there and that one, are the left and right output level controls for analog playback. And one channel is playing slightly louder than the other. So I just tweaked that one right there until they're both the same. And now it plays perfectly. I believe that's the Dolby decoder, since it says Dolby right next to it. It's actually a Sony chip, which is kind of ironic because they were pushing mini disc at the time. And they were Philips' main rival in that fight, but yet Philips used some Sony parts in this machine. The controls are largely similar to any other high-end cassette deck, including auto reverse, automatic track skipping for both analog and digital tapes. And if you want proof that most people never owned a high-quality cassette deck, just look in the comments of my 13 Reasons Why Cassettes Are Cool Again video. You'll see the number one complaint people post is that it takes so long to find the song they want to listen to on a cassette, because they have to fast forward or rewind until they find it. Those people obviously never owned or probably never even heard of a cassette deck that could automatically find the tracks on the tape. That feature was most commonly called automatic music search, and this one has it. You also get Dolby B and C noise reduction for analog tapes, recording level and balance controls. Originally came with a remote control, although it did not get it with one. Even the tray loading design was not unheard of with cassette decks in the 90s. I know Denon made some of them. So it was not totally unusual to see a cassette deck that would load a tape like this. But if you look closer, you see some differences. For example, this input selector for analog, digital, optical, or automatic. You get a text button for displaying text information on digital tapes, which this one says no text info because it's an analog tape. And you get all these buttons for writing markers on digital tapes when you're recording them. This would let you set up the tracks for your recordings. And something else you won't normally see on a cassette deck are digital inputs and outputs. On this one, you get both coaxial and optical. In fact, if I pull off these little covers, you can see the optical output is active. And it was assembled in Japan. But I did get it with the original owner's manual, which is very helpful to have. And the original owner apparently ordered some part for it for $4.50. They wrote down an order number and the 1-800 number to call. So I don't know what kind of part would have cost only $4.50 for this thing. But there's the original owner's manual. And I also happen to have the remote for my Philips FR930 Mark II receiver. I still need to do a proper review of that receiver. So far, I've only done a video demonstrating its wideband AM audio quality. But this is the remote for it, and you can see it has a DCC button right on it. So this remote can actually control this unit, which is very nice to have. Because I doubt I would be able to find an original remote for this tape deck. So I can open and close the tray, I can play a tape, I can fast forward and rewind. And to go along with my working DCC deck, I added a few more DCC tapes to my collection. I still have the John Hiatt tape I tried to play on the Optimus, and thankfully on this one it plays perfectly. I also got the Ultimate DCC collection, which was Philips original sampler tape for the format, with 22 tracks on it. Most of them are classical pieces, but it does have some popular songs from the time towards the beginning there, such as Vanessa Williams, Lionel Richie, U2, and so on and so forth. And one's from 1992, so that was right at the start of the DCC format. And I just got this one. It's the first new DCC album release in over 20 years. Jeremy Haydn's Blue Wicked. So I'll be opening this one up and using it as part of my demonstration. But first I'll give you a little sample of analog cassette playback with the Fantasy Challenge.
Welcome to your claim to fame's Fantasy Challenge. Hi, this is Pat Summerall. Each week we bring you great golf from the top tournaments in the country, filled with some truly unbelievable surprises. Now let's go out on the course with Nigel Ashcroft and catch up with the amazing story that's unfolding here.
Thank you, Pat. That story we're alluding to here at the U.S. Open is the possible record-shattering performance by a heretofore unheralded newcomer.
And now, finally, we'll get to hear what a digital compact cassette sounds like. Now, I'll be using the analog outputs of the DCC deck because it's pretty much impossible to find a computer sound card with a digital audio input. Probably due to copy protection nonsense, but the analog outputs on this thing should be very high quality. And the built-in Realtek HD audio of this keyboard PC is also very high quality. I've used it for many of my audio demonstrations and it's always sounded very good. The main limiting factor, of course, will be YouTube's lossy compression of the audio. So you'll just have to keep in mind that in real life, it'll sound better than what you're hearing from this video.
Oh, it breaks my heart to see those stars smashing a perfect.
And once again, here's opening of a brand new steel-sealed DCC tape by Jeremy Haydn. The first new album released on DCC in over 20 years. Hopefully I don't need tools to get into this, but it looks like it's coming apart. There we go. And there's the tape itself. Of the shutter on the back there. You can see the sprockets, and that's just the clear leader on there. Let's take a look at the little booklet. Oh, it has this little insert here with some more pictures and a little decal there. It's actually autographed too. So thank you, Jeremy, for that. That's very nice. The Digital Compact Cassette System offers superior sound reproduction on a small portable sound carrier unit. I believe that's just copied from the original text you would see in a DCC tape back in the day. And there's even more on the back here. If I can get that out, maybe a little bit stiff, so I think I'll leave that in, but normally this little back part can be removed and it has a little bit more information in there. So that's your tour of a DCC tape. The little booklet slips into the holders here, so it's a lot neater than the fold-out cards that would come in analog cassettes. And then the tape would just slip into the top and click into place so it doesn't fall out. So I really like the design of these DCC tapes. And of course they fit in the same holders as regular cassettes. So if you have a rack or something for cassettes, this would fit just fine. So now I'll give you a sample of what it sounds like.
It's hard to believe.
I wanted to test recording with this deck, and one of the downsides of DCC decks is that they cannot record onto regular cassettes in either analog or digital mode. Well, actually, there's a hack you can do by drilling special holes into a cassette to make it think it's recording onto a DCC tape. And if it's a very high quality metal tape, you may be able to get it to work. I believe Dr. DCC has a video demonstrating that on his channel. But normally you'll need a special DCC tape in order to record, so they're not too expensive and they're pretty easy to find on eBay. It's a 60 minute Fuji tape. So I'll unwrap it here on camera. Okay, now I guess I can just pull that off like that. It's interesting that it doesn't come in one of those cases where it slides out through the top. It's a lot closer to a regular cassette housing, except you can see it has these weird angles there. That's interesting. And it even has a little window in it, something that pre-recorded DCC tapes don't have. You can still do the old trick of moving the spools by your hand or by a pencil or whatever. So that's a blank DCC tape. Delivers lifelike sound when used for digital recording and playback. And there's the Write Protect tab, which disables recording on both sides. So even though there's only one that actually controls both sides of the tape, not like analog cassettes where you get separate ones for each side. So now I can try recording onto a DCC tape. I wanted to have a good uncompressed digital source to record from, so I pulled out my Sensui CD player, and it has a coaxial digital output on the back, which I just connected using an ordinary RCA cable to the coaxial digital input of the DCC deck. I put in my blank DCC tape and followed the instructions in the manual, and now it's in record pause mode and it's set to the digital coaxial input from the CD player, and that's what we're seeing on the level meter right there. And when you're recording from a digital source, the level control does nothing. The level is determined by whatever's on the CD, and you can see it's set to 44 kilohertz because that's what a CD is. It also supports 48 kilohertz, such as for dubbing from a DAT tape, and also 32 kilohertz, which I believe DAT also supports in its longer playing mode. So I'm going to record some tracks from the CD onto the tape, and then I'll play it back and see how it sounds. And since it's St. Patrick's Day when I'm recording this part of the video, I picked some Irish music from Derek Ryan. You can see right there, County Tyrone, Ireland, which is actually Northern Ireland. And this thing has automatic track separation whenever it detects a silent part, or actually I think it picks up the tracks when you're using a digital connection. So yes, we saw exactly when this CD player began track 2, the tape began track 2. So it is picking up the tracks from the CD. So I'm very happy to finally have a working DCC deck, and again I must give my thanks to Dr. DCC from the DCC Museum for his help in getting it working again. And if you have one of these decks that hasn't been restored yet, please get that done before it's too late, because even though DCC was a failed format, it's a wonderful piece of technology and it really should be preserved.